Okay, the Christ has risen. Happy Easter. Today, as we begin our worship service today, I want to read to you the earliest historical record that we have of the resurrection. It does not come out of the Gospels. Paul wrote before the Gospels were ever written. So this comes out of the 15th chapter of Corinthians, the First Corinthians. Hear this, as I said, the first historical account that we have of the resurrection. Paul writes, "For I handed on to you as a first importance of what in turn I had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance to the Scriptures." My friends, Christ has risen. Let us stand and let us sing Happy Days with our band members.
Friends, day in history, death is beaten, you have rescued me. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Gracious and loving God, today is indeed a glorious day. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the hope, for the love, for the grace that is ours through Jesus Christ. We thank you for this day of resurrection that fills our hearts with your love. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. And let us sing Christ the Lord has risen today.
Good morning. Welcome. Happy Easter. What a glorious day outside. It's so beautiful, and it's so wonderful to have all of you here today. It's just great to look out and see all these smiling faces, some new, some familiar, but we're so glad to have you here. So the announcements this morning is there is a survey in the back, and if you want me to bring you one when we're done with announcements, just put your hand up and I'll bring it to you. It was also sent out online, but they are due tomorrow, and it's a worship survey. And also a congregational meeting is coming up on May 1st after the worship service, so please pencil that into your calendar to stay just a little bit later. Blessing bags. Our friend Karen is not here this morning. She is with her grandbaby in Virginia. But she makes these blessing bags that are gallon size. I keep mine in my vehicle, but it's to give out to folks that are homeless, that are looking for some assistance. It has some food and some different items in there. They're a nice thing to have for sure. The prayer chain. If you have any concerns that you'd like to bring to the prayer chain, you can contact Kathy. contact Kathy with any prayer concerns. And I have to tell you, that is such a powerful thing, the prayer chain. It made a huge difference in my parents' life after my dad's house burned down unexpectedly. And you could just feel it. He could feel it, and I could see it. And so it is powerful. Don't be afraid to ask. Don't be shy. You know, give your problems to the Lord. Next prayer breakfast is May 7th. All are welcome. And on every third Friday, we do a Friday food distribution. And we just did one this past Friday. And boy, that was great to be out there on Good Friday and serving and all these wonderful people coming through. So if you'd be interested in serving in that, you just have to be here at 1:30. It's a lot of fun. If you are interested in coming through the line and getting some food, you're absolutely welcome to. You just need a driver's license, Stacy. Is that right? Okay. And volunteers for the food pantry, Tuesdays 5 to 7 and Thursdays 11 to 2, if anyone's interested in helping with that. And on Tuesdays, our pastor sends out a word from the pastor, which I've really been enjoying that. If you do not have your email in with the church and you would like to have it in with the church, come and see me after service, and I'll get that written down and turned into the office for you. So again, thank you so much, all of you, for being here today. Have a wonderful day celebrating. He is risen. Amen.
Good morning, church family. Please join me in the pastoral prayer. Gracious God, we come before you and we live in the moment that we currently see. We see that we were walking towards the tomb expecting to see death, but instead it was empty and we see resurrection. And in that moment, we realize that everything that you said you were has come to pass, and you literally changed the course of human history. And as these women go back to the town to tell everybody what they saw, the nonsense that they heard, they knew it to be true, so they kept persevering. And God, as we sit here and we face our own metaphorical deaths, let them be buried with you. Let them now be resurrected with you. As we come into a new life with you, God, we need not fear death. We need not fear the things that this world can throw at us, for we are more than conquerors because of what you have done in our place. And as we see this new life, this resurrection, this wonderful time of new living in you, may we truly hold on to that and claim that as our own. May we claim that new life. May we claim that freedom. May we claim the ability to be able to shrug off everything that we fear in this world, because you have already taken it from us. Your resurrection in this moment brings us a life that we could never have had on our own but for you. And so let us live into that. Let us live what we believe. And let us never forget that we live as Easter people. We live in a resurrected Christ. We live in a resurrected spirit, not in the past. So help us to remember these things as we also reach out to you and pray to you in the way that you have taught us to. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our song of praise will be He Lives.
Please join us for the Apostles' Creed. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. Believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. We're going to have a children's sermon. So the children, I know Riley and her brother are here. Would y'all come up and anybody else? Okay. This time, let's sit over on this side. Okay. What is your name again?
Jaden.
Hi, Jaden. Glad you're here. We're waiting for your sister. Let's see. While we're waiting for your sister, I want you to say, Jaden, I want you to say into the microphone, can you do that? Can you say, Christ has risen?
Christ is living.
Yeah, remember the beginning of worship? Ready? He's going to say, Christ is risen. So, ready? Christ has risen.
Christ is living.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's see. I wanted the little girl to be here as well. We may have to just start without her. Well, I have something I wanted to show you. Have you ever seen, what do you think's in here? Eggs. And this is called resurrection eggs. So this is one way that we can tell the story of Easter. So when I open it up, see all these eggs, and every one of them's full of something. Now, it's this. I love this so much that I want you to turn around and look at the screen. Here she comes. Hi, Riley. Glad you're here. So turn around and look at the screen, because we're gonna talk about these eggs here. It's called the resurrection eggs. And so each one of them has something in it that's going to tell us the story of Easter. So the very first one, you open it up and there's a donkey. Why would there be a donkey? Because of Palm Sunday, and Jesus rode into town on the back of a donkey. So the second egg, money. Why is there money? Because Judas betrayed Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. So that tells the story. The money is there representing the betrayal of Jesus. The chalice, the cup. Why would the cup be there? Because of the last, I think he helped you there. Because of the Last Supper. The next one. Praying hands. Jesus, after the Last Supper, the scriptures tell us that Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. So that reminds us of Jesus going to the garden. The whip. When Jesus was arrested, you know what they did to him? They whipped him. That was really painful, right? And then a rooster. Why is there a rooster up in these eggs? Because when Jesus told Peter that you will deny me before the cock crows, before the rooster crows. And so it reminds us of that story. The next one, that one's kind of hard to see, but it's a crown of thorns. So when they were getting ready to crucify Jesus, they put a crown of thorns on his head. And the next one, what's that? It's the cross. So that reminds us of the crucifixion of Jesus. And then the spear, where the soldiers pierced Jesus in the side. It's kind of a sad story, isn't it? And then when they took the body of Jesus down, they wrapped him in a cloth. So that's there. And then you remember where they laid Jesus? They laid him in a tomb, and they rolled a stone in front of the tomb. Now, the last one, what do you think's in the last one? Well, I think the last one is empty. Empty because of what? Because Jesus rose from the dead. He didn't stay in the tomb. He rose from the dead. And so that's kind of a cool way to tell the story of Easter, of Passion Week and all the things that happened in Easter. So I wanted to share that with you. And I want to thank Joe for, Joe, right? Yes. I want to thank Joe for coming up and sitting with us as well. So can we say a word of prayer? Gracious God, we thank you for Easter. We thank you for the story of Easter, especially the resurrection of the empty tomb. We ask that you be with these children this Easter. Spread your blanket of love and grace over them. And we thank you, O God, for giving us the task of raising them as your sons and your daughters. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, thank you all. Tell you what, is somebody going to take them back? If you want to take these back, you can look at them, because there's those things in every one of them, okay? Who is reading scripture this morning? Okay.
But on the first day of the week at early dawn, they came to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified, and on the third day rise again." Then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened.
So it's finally here. Today is Easter, the high point of the Christian year. You know, it seems to me that Easter is a terrible thing to waste. You want to go to the next slide? One more. There you go. Easter is a terrible thing to waste. It really is. But sometimes it happens. I heard about a very large church once where there was a 15-year-old tradition of having 500 lilies on Easter morning. I don't know why there were 500, but every year there would be 500 lilies. They would take the 500 lilies and they would place them on a huge cross that was built for the occasion. It was a huge sanctuary, great big cross on the back of the church. The cross stood high against the sanctuary wall. It must have been beautiful. They were memorial lilies. People would give $15 for a lily, and there would be an insert in the bulletin on Sunday morning, on Easter morning, with 500 names on it, 500 lilies, $15 each. In the 16th year of that tradition, it almost fell apart. One of the elderly members of the church, a woman who had not been a member for very long, she went up after the Easter service, and she said, "I'm going to the hospital this afternoon to visit a friend, and can I take one of the lilies to her room? And I know I can't tell which one that I gave, but they all look alike, and my friend would really like one. I know it would lift her spirits." And without really waiting to get an answer, she went up to the cross of 500 lilies. She picked one up. And then she turned to those who remained in the sanctuary, and in a shocked voice, she shouted, "They're fake! They're fake! They're artificial! They're fake!" Well, that created quite a scene. You see, not everybody knew that they were fake lilies. Oh, the people on the church board, they knew it. The people who built the cross and put the lilies on it, they knew it. It wasn't a secret. The church just stopped publicizing the fact that the memorial lilies were not real lilies. There was a lot of concern. People started to say, but we gave $15 for a lily. If it's artificial, it may be the same one that was used last year. And we gave $15 last year. And during the week, people started to talk about these artificial lilies. Someone came up with a figure that over 15 years, $120,000 were given for the same lilies. The next Sunday, the minister gathered those concerned together, and he tried to defend the practice of having artificial lilies year after year after year. They were stored in a cool, dark place. They were covered. It was a practice that was started by his predecessor. You know, as pastors, when you get in trouble, you blame your predecessor if you can. They had indeed lasted for years. They were still beautiful. From even up close, you couldn't really tell that they were fake lilies. His defense was along three lines. The first two were the practical defenses. He said the proceeds were given to an outreach contingency fund. The church had been able to help the poor and meet emergency needs in the community that wasn't budgeted in the unified budget. He was sorry that they didn't publicize that the lilies were not real, but it was an oversight, and he said it would not happen again. But the money had gone to good use, and every penny of it could be accounted for. And there was whispered and reluctant acceptance with this argument by some, rejection by others. He also pointed out that 500 lilies would create such an odor in the sanctuary. Some people are allergic to that odor, so that was the reason they needed to be artificial. His other line of defense was theological. He said, after all, and he said this with enthusiasm, after all, artificial lilies are more appropriate for Easter because they never die. They always bloom. They never die. And then he said, after all, we don't want to waste Easter. Well, you know, he was right about one thing. Easter is a terrible thing to waste, but it can be wasted. It has been my concern, especially us in the Protestant traditions, that we have lost the meaning of Easter by its increasing detachment from Good Friday. We just kind of skip over Good Friday occasionally as we go from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday as if Good Friday never really happened. But without Calvary, Easter cannot happen. Without Calvary, you cannot have Easter because you cannot have a resurrection if nobody is dead. Jesus was dead. He was dead. He wasn't sleeping. He wasn't in a coma or anything. He was dead. All the books in the New Testament say that. What was the proclamation of the early church? In Acts 5, it says this, Jesus whom you hung on a tree, God rose from the dead. He doesn't say that he was in a deep, deep sleep. He was dead. If you don't believe the biblical witness, then go back and ask the soldiers at the cross. They'll tell you, hey, Mr. Centurion, was Jesus dead? You're talking about the one in the middle? Yeah, he was dead. We made sure of that. He was dead. You go ask the disciples, Peter, James, and John, was Jesus dead? Yeah, he was dead. We were kind of far off in the distance, but we could tell that Jesus was dead. You ask Joseph, who took the body of Jesus and laid him in the tomb. Joseph, was Jesus dead? Yes, Jesus was dead. You ask his mother, Mary, was your boy dead? She'll tell you, my boy was dead. You see, it is important for us to know that Jesus was dead because you cannot have a resurrection if nobody is dead. Jesus was dead. Let's don't kid ourselves. You know, it's not Christmas anymore. Somebody go tell the shepherds that it was all a mistake. They must have been mistaken when they heard the angels sing glory to God in the highest. In light of Calvary, in light of the death of Jesus, all of our Christmas carols, they just kind of seem silly, don't they? Go tell it on the mountain, joy to the world. Hark, the herald angels sing glory to the newborn king. Who are we kidding? Jesus is dead. Go tell the wise men that their gifts were nice, but it must have been a case of mistaken identity. Jesus is dead. Tell Herod that he wins again. In fact, it was rather naive for us to think that we could change anything. Tell Caesar that Rome is safe. It's all over. The rulers win again. The disenfranchised, the poor, as usually, that they have lost. Jesus is dead. I'm sure that on Good Friday, those who were closest to Jesus must have felt like they had experienced a lost campaign. Have you ever been a part of a lost campaign, a campaign that you really, really, really believed in? The people went to the polls on election day, and it was Barabbas by a landslide. All in favor of Barabbas, raise your hands. Well, we don't even have to count. Someone needs to go down and to the supporters and workers that they're feeling low right now. Somebody needs to go tell them that a message has been sent to Barabbas congratulating him on his apparent victory. Apparently, Barabbas was the people's choice. It's all over. There's nothing left to do but go home. We ran a fine race. We thought we were gaining some momentum on Palm Sunday. We thought things were beginning to break our way on Palm Sunday. The opinion polls were turning into our favor on Palm Sunday, but Barabbas had us beat all along. It was kind of silly to think that we could actually win. Somebody told me once that losing an important campaign is like a death in the family. It's the same dull ache as when you have a death in the family. When you have a sudden death in the family, it's the most confusing, meaningless time. Everything's in slow motion, and all you want it to do is be over with. And there are all those people, they bring in that food. You're hungry all of your life, and now that you can't eat a thing, you have all that food in the kitchen. And Mama, would it be all right if we take the children to the park? Mama, they're so bored. They don't have anything to do. They don't understand all of this, Mama. I'm going to take the children to the park. Is that okay, Mama? And Mama, when you clean out Jesus' room, I think James would like to have his carpenter's apron. Is that okay, Mama? I think Jesus would have liked for James to have his carpenter's apron. James was such a good brother. Let's let him have his apron and maybe his hammer as well. My friends, the only way we can understand the joy of Easter is to live through the agony of Good Friday. But unfortunately, many people live their whole lives trying to escape the reality of Good Friday. Easter is a terrible thing to waste, but it can be wasted if it is not a dead Jesus that is raised. There's no nourishment in the belief that he was not really dead. Jesus was dead. There's no nourishment in saying, oh, it was a moral victory. There's no nourishment in saying he just appeared to be dead. Our Christian faith cannot survive on that type of watery nothing. There's not a calorie in it, not one. The minister was wrong. Artificial lilies do not bloom always. Artificial lilies never bloom, because in order to bloom, something has to be able to die. In order for it to bloom, it has to be able to die. This Easter, I want to share with you a very personal story. It happened 40 years ago this week. And even though it's been 40 years, it's still hard for me to tell. It seems like it was only yesterday. Now, the way I'm going to tell this story is not unique to me. I cannot claim that, but I promise you it is a true story. And I am painfully aware that for many of you, it will be your story as well. And so I share this very personal story with you as my gift to you on Easter. It was right at 41 years ago. I had finished my first semester of seminary, and I had gone back home to be with my parents on Christmas. I was in my mid-20s then. There were lots of family, lots of food, lots of laughter. We had a great time. Everybody was there. It was a good Christmas, except we noticed that my father was acting a little strange. On Christmas Day, he spent the whole day looking through family picture albums, all day, hour after hour after hour. At first, we didn't think anything of it, but it went on and on and on. It became an obsession with him. We didn't know what was going on. He had been complaining of a headache all day, but we didn't know what was wrong. We just knew that something was wrong. The night after Christmas, there was a knock on my father's door, and he got up to see who it was. When he opened the door, old man Death stood there staring at him with those cold, dark eyes. My father slammed the door in his face. The next morning, we took him to the doctor. The doctor came out and said, "I'm sorry, it's cancer." He said it was a fast-growing tumor, and my father had to have emergency surgery or he was going to die within just a few days. All through the operation, we thought we saw old man Death was standing outside that operating room, but then the surgeon came out. He had a big smile on his face. He said it went well. He said we got most of it. That's what he said. We got most of it. After the operation, we didn't see old man Death anymore. We thought he had left. We thought we had won. We thought that we were victorious. I mean, my father got better. It was as if a great cloud of stress had been lifted from us. I even played golf with him one day. He loved playing golf. And of course, there were the trips to the MD Anderson Hospital in Houston. There were the chemotherapy. There was the radiation. But you know, no. After going through a major brain surgery, that wasn't so bad. And we found even moments of joy and blessing during that time. Every once in a while, we thought we would see old man Death standing outside of his window, but we weren't sure. We certainly didn't want to see him there. About 6 months after the surgery, he got pneumonia. We almost lost him then, but he kept fighting, and he kept fighting, and he kept fighting. He kept turning old man Death away at the door, and you know, we kind of had a good time. We even told jokes. We'd say, "Hey, Dad, you look good without any hair. It makes you look distinguished." And he'd say, yeah, I think I'll wear it like this all the time. And during that time, we got to know each other better. My sister is 10 years older than I am, and when I was just a little boy, she left home. I never did really get to know her. So during that time, we started to get to know one another. Our family bonds grew stronger. One day, there was another knock at the door. My father answered the door, and there he stood again with old, frosted breath, staring into that room, waiting to come in. My mother called us home. She called us home. She called us home, and we took turns leaning against that door. We were not going to let old man Death in that room. We leaned against the door, leaned against the door. We knew that old man Death was right outside that room. My father was so ill. He was so weak. He was suffering so much. My father was so weak, he could not lean against the door himself. He couldn't even hold his head up. He was so ill. So we leaned against the door for him. We were not going to get away from that door night after night, day after day. We leaned against that door. Old man Death was not going to get into that room. But one day, my father said, "Get away from the door. Daddy, don't say that. Daddy, if we move away from the door, Daddy, don't say that. And my father said, get away from the door. You know, when that door opened, I was never so shocked at anything in all of my life. I was absolutely amazed. You see, sometimes when death enters a room, it fills the room with fear and pain and suffering and anger and hate. The death of a child, the death of a young person, the death of a young parent. I have certainly been in rooms where death entered as an unwanted enemy. But because of the suffering my father had gone through, when death entered his room, it did so with an olive branch in one hand and a dove in the other. After death entered that room, we gathered at the church 3 days later. We gathered at the church and we sang hymns. You should have heard how we sung those hymns. We sang, God of grace and God of glory, on thy people pour thy power. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the facing of this hour, for the facing of this hour. We sang, so I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. We read scripture, do not let your hearts be troubled. In my father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I go to tell you that I prepare a place for you? And if I prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you will be also. I wish you'd been there to hear how we sang those hymns and read that scripture. Do you know why we could gather at the church 3 days after my father died to sing those songs and read that scripture? Do you know why we could gather together and do something like that on that occasion? We could sing those hymns and we could read that scripture because of today, because of Easter. Easter is a terrible thing to waste, so don't waste it. Live into its joy, live into its hope, live into its promise. Death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through Christ Jesus. Christ has risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. 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 Amen. Let us sing our next song.
Stand in the grave.
That was beautiful. Thank you. Please be seated. Carol is preaching in Silverton today, so we keep her in our prayers and our presence today. When Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples, he said, took the bread, and said, "Do this in remembrance of me." We oftentimes don't quite understand that word remembrance. We think of it as do this, remember me, as if I'm going to remember the birth of my first son and my second son, and I will recall those things that happened during that birth. I will recall them in my mind as memory. But in the Hebrew, the word remembrance doesn't quite mean the same thing. In the Hebrew, the word remembrance means to make present again. To make present again. So when Jesus says, "Do this in remembrance of me," what he's actually saying is, do this because I am with you. I am with you. As our people, as our communion servers come forward, it is not them that is serving you communion. It is Christ that is serving you communion. We do this in remembrance, making Jesus present again. On the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread.
Same way, after supper, he took the cup. And he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, for this table of remembrance, for the presence of Christ in our midst, we thank you. We thank you for this Easter morning. We thank you for this remembrance every week. Christ not only lived and died years ago and was resurrected, but that Christ lives with us today. In Christ's name we pray. If I could come forward and share communion by intention, our communion servers will tear off a piece of bread and hand it to you. And you can either dip it in the juice or the wine. Let us do this in remembrance of Jesus. Thank you.
Again, it is good to have you here on Easter. The drive down this morning was as beautiful as it is. It's just beautiful weather. I love the spring in Colorado. Let us hear one last time this passage of Scripture found in 1 Corinthians. I shared it at the end of my sermon. Death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through Jesus Christ our Lord. Christ is risen. Amen.